Hi, and welcome to my talk, Optimization. This talk and these slides are under CC by SA, copyright Ken Wong, copyright Abram Hindle. This is meant for education use. So today we're going to talk about code tuning. So the purpose of tuning is basically to improve performance. Usually the performance is some kind of quality, like flexibility, correctness, maintainability. Our intent here is to basically get code to run more efficiently, whether that's in time, space, less power, but we also don't really want to change the functional behavior of the code. So if we want it to go faster, but we have to make some kind of changes to our requirements, that's not really tuning. That is changing the requirements of our code. Unfortunately, when we try to improve something like performance, it tends to work against other qualities. For instance, if we drop accuracy down a little bit, we might make performance gains, but at the same time we might lose in correctness. So Donald Knuth has said, "Premature optimization is the root of all evil." Now, he's not saying that optimization is evil. He's saying that optimizing ahead of time, before testing, before analyzing, before understanding what your problem is, tends to lead to a lot of problems. What he's really talking about is the fact that you might follow certain patterns because you heard they were faster. These patterns might be less maintainable. They might involve using less abstraction just because you think that they're faster. But you might be wasting your time, and you might be wasting other developers' time doing this. The argument here is you should look at what you're doing, and you should test it somehow. So, we've got here the first rule of program optimization: don't do it. The second rule of program optimization: don't do it yet. This was by Michael A. Jackson, preeminent researcher in the field. Now, really what he's getting at is, in many cases you don't need optimization, and you don't need to do it yet. Oftentimes you can put it off. The reason why optimization has such a bad rap is because it tends to really infringe on maintainability. It tends to infringe on the time it takes for developers to make some software. If performance is very important, design for performance at the start. Designing for performance is not the same as optimization. Designing for performance is addressing a non-functional requirement that you have to meet. Optimization is taking what you have and trying to make it faster, maybe by removing abstractions or further analysis of the system. So there's different levels of optimization, and the levels range from, say, requirements. So if we have a non-functional requirement that says we have to respond in 10 milliseconds, that might be the acceptable performance. 10 milliseconds is oftentimes used as the sort of maximum delay that one can give to computer music users. So if someone is playing a piano keyboard or something like that, the maximum delay that they can incur is about 10 milliseconds. Gamers might be able to deal with more delay, and they might train for more delay, ranging from 60 to 100 milliseconds, but lots of gamers don't like more than 100 milliseconds. Remember that 100 milliseconds is a tenth of a second, right? The requirements might also dictate how much data there is. So if you know you're not dealing with a lot of data, you might use in-memory stuff. If you know you're dealing with tons of data, you might deal with disk or over network. If you know you're dealing with too much data, you might not even go over the network, just because it's a lot slower than the disk in many cases. You might not be able to transmit a couple terabytes of data very quickly, and thus you might be stuck putting that on disk. Another problem is that the boundedness of the problem. So imagine you want to compare all pairs of things. All pairs is about an n squared kind of algorithm. So the more data we have, the slower we get. But things can be worse. We could look at something like the power set, where we want all subsets of things. This would create many different permutations of, say, an array, and the larger your array got, the more difficult it would be to address. So the more time it would take, because it's basically n factorial. So we were just talking about requirements as an optimization level. Another one is high-level design. So when you're approaching something like optimization, you have to consider by treating things generically, by adding generality, you tend to actually affect performance. You tend to do this through indirection. In languages like C++, where you compile each module separately, indirection can't be optimized out very easily. But in languages like Java, the JIT can sometimes allow for optimization of indirection because it can look for hot paths, that is, paths through the code that you commonly take, and provide means of improving those hot paths. What you can often do with indirection is you can improve it by replacing the slow parts. So you profile the code, you see which parts are slow, you see which parts are heavy, and you try to replace those parts. If you can replace a small bit of code and get a big gain at a low maintainability cost, then it's worth it. So we were just talking about high-level design. There's also the detailed design. The detailed design is when you really consider the algorithmic complexity. So not just at the generality level, not at the computer architecture level, but at the algorithmic complexity level. So we're basically looking at space and time complexity. So you might consider optimizing a system by switching out algorithms. In a language like C++, it's very easy to make a data structure that can have multiple algorithms that operate on it. The templates really allow for this. You can often provide the algorithm or the strategy as a parameter to the template. You can do the same thing with Java. It's just not done as commonly, but it is very useful. So you could have the same task be accomplished in different ways by basically an algorithm being injected. So let's look at these two algorithms. Algorithm A is an n log n time algorithm. It's basically it takes a constant of a1 times n times log n plus a2 times n plus a3. Algorithm 2 is n squared. This is supposed to be a square. And it's basically b1 times n squared plus b2 times n plus b3. Which one of these is faster? Well, the fact is, it depends. The reason why it depends is it depends on n, but it also depends on these constants. If this constant was 1 million, right? If A3 was 1 million, right? And B3 and the sum of these altogether was far less than 1 million for the same n, then this algorithm would be slower. Alternatively, if n was very large, this algorithm would grow larger very quickly compared to this one. So it depends on the constants. For instance, quicksort tends to be slower than insertion sort for small numbers of n. This is because quicksort is going to operate over everything, require random numbers, require flipping and switching, whereas insertion sort oftentimes you don't have to do a lot of work, especially if the thing's already sorted. So different algorithms have different prices at different sizes. So oftentimes for quicksort, the cost of insertion sort is lower at smaller n's than for quicksort. So here's a memoization example. So we've got a Fibonacci generator, right? In this Fibonacci generator, we recursively call Fibonacci in order to generate the Fibonacci numbers. You can see that we've got a Fibonacci static method here. It takes an n. If the n is 0 or 1, it returns 1. Otherwise, it returns fib n minus 1 plus fib n minus 2. If we called, say, the Fibonacci number of 4, so 1, 2, 3, 4, it would have to work out fib minus 1 twice, and it would have to work out fib minus 2 once. If we called 5, it'd have to work out the Fibonacci of 4 before it could do this, right? So this one might be faster for very quick checks, and if memory access was slow, this one might be faster. This one, on the other hand, is probably faster for larger larger values of n. So this is a memoized version, so we basically record the results. So if the result is not known, if we've got it set to 0, then we do our normal Fibonacci. But we are calling this method. So if we do know the result, we return it. All right. So this is pretty well the same code. That code is there. That code's there. The return statement here is moved down to here. Right. But what happens is that when we call, if we call fib n1, n minus 1, by the time this one returns, it will be able to answer this one simply by looking up into the array. Right? So this means that we'll only calculate a result, a Fibonacci number, once. And furthermore, every time we calculate a new one, it will rely on the results of the older ones. So we will only deal with a Fibonacci number once. In this case, with a Fibonacci of 8, we would deal with the Fibonacci of 1 like 7 times, we deal with the Fibonacci of 2 6 times, so forth. We deal with these numbers quite a bit. I think I'm actually wrong on that one. But the point is that we make lots of repeated calls. In this one, we know that we make repeated calls, but we cache the results. If memory is slow, if this data structure is very slow, this one still might take less time than this one. But in general, this one will usually be faster because we will eventually work out the results. So here's more comments on detailed design. So basically, we can choose the algorithms that have fewer expensive operations. For instance, for floating point and for integers, oftentimes multiplication is slower than addition. But we're just assuming in this case. You really have to test this. So this is x to the 4, this is x to the 3, this is x to the 2, right? Okay. So if you look here, we've got one multiplication right here, two multiplication, three multiplication, four multiplication, and then if we count the powers, we've got 3, 2, 1, right? So that's 6 plus 4, that's 10. That's 10 multiplications for this one. Whereas this one, we got 1, 2, so we got 1, 2, 3, 4. We got 4 multiplications. So we dropped down 6 multiplications just by switching to this Horner's method where we compute the same thing, but because we can see that we can break the multiplication out, we can use